floor is all yours.
Okay. So good morning, everybody. I'm going to give three. I've been persuaded to give three talks. In the first talk, I'm going to tell you about to what extent we comprehend, not understand.
Oh, I think you can all hear me anyway. Tomorrow, I'm going to discuss the evolution of the arthropod brain from the point of view of its ground pattern, the ground pattern organization across all the arthropods. For those that are engineers, arthropods include spiders, crustaceans, nice animals you can eat, and insects. And bring to your attention a very important question, which is, to what extent do arthropod brains share structures that are within our brains? And I hope, if not convince you, then at least whet your appetites that there are, in fact, systems in the brain of a fly or a crustacean that are no different from systems in the brain of you and me, and that these systems must have originated very, very early in the evolutionary history of animals. And on Thursday, I shall return to the visual system and ask how old it is, and introduce you to a new aspect of studies of brains, which is called paleoneurobiology, which involves the analysis of fossil brains. And then we'll discover, you know, how long structures that I'm going to talk about this morning have existed on this planet. And it's a very long time indeed. Okay, but today I'm going to talk about the visual system of insects and what we think we understand about how they're organized. And I'm going to start off with the historical background, because I think one should actually have a little bit of extension into the past and what people have done beforehand, particularly here in Spain, as you'll see presently. And then I'm going to talk about motion detection and what we know about the neurons that encode directional motion, and what we know about neurons that perhaps actually synthesize or put together, compute, the direction of motion. And the answer is actually not terribly much, surprisingly. And then a few examples of how neurons encode visual flow fields, which is very important. And I'm sure Srini will talk about more about this tomorrow. And then reconstruction of the visual world. What does an insect perhaps see in terms of simple parameters out there? Certainly not what we see. And what neurons are actually encoding features of the visual world, which is a rather new line of approach in this whole game. And then finally, origins and evolution. And as I said, origins and evolution will be deferred until Thursday morning. So let's start off with the historical background. And it's important to start with that, because the historical background actually extends very far back in time. Namely, Jan Swammerdam, the great Dutch anatomist, who was the first to dissect any brain of an insect. This is a bee's brain. This is a terrible pointer. This is a bee's brain, and this is a bee's head. He used an incredibly simple microscope for these dissections. The dissections are quite wonderful. And he discovered that, in fact, that the eye of an insect is composed of these small units called ommatidia, each of which perceives a point or a small area of the visual world, the visual surroundings of the animal. It's called the compound eye, and we shall talk about how the organization of these facets, these dioptric facets, how the organization of these facets is represented in the deeper brain. And the nice thing about insect brains is that, at least the visual system, they're very accessible, they're smallish, and there's a very precise representation of every single sampling point of the retina within the brain beneath. But it is very, very helpful for people using electrophysiology trying to relate the visual fields of neurons, of the dendritic fields of neurons, to the visual world around the animal. Okay. However, the real story began here in Spain. And that's why I want to impress upon you the history of this. And the person who started all this was Ramon Ramon y Cajal, Santiago Ramon y Cajal, who started his life here just south of Barcelona in Valencia, and then later on moved to Madrid. And he won the Nobel Prize in 1909 for medicine and physiology. So from the 1880s to the 1930s, he actually was the founder of modern neuroanatomy. And he's also the instigator of the neuron theory. He decided, or he proposed, that neurons are single entities. They don't form a syncytium. They are single entities that communicate with each other at what Sherrington later described as synapses. Sherrington was a great friend of Cajal. Cajal was an extraordinary man. He worked obsessively, and he began to work on the insect brain only in 1909, having already, you know, achieved Nobel fame and having produced amazing amount of work on all sorts of vertebrate brains, including humans. This was a prodigious effort. And finally, he worked on the insect. And he had a colleague, this guy here, Domingo Sanchez y Sanchez, who was a fantastic neuroanatomist too, and a very good biologist, who is known for his work on apoptosis, which is programmed cell death, which is very, very crucial in development of all nervous systems, and also on glial cells in nervous system. And he described glial cells as being characteristic of both vertebrates and invertebrates. These are some of Cajal's original preparations that I photographed in Madrid some time ago. Very beautiful Golgi preparations of honeybee neurons. That's one of his slides. And this is Sanchez. This is Sanchez de Sanchez, and these are the glial cells that he used to stain with the Golgi method. Golgi silver chromate impregnation. And he described the glial cells as being almost identical to those in the vertebrate brain. And they're very interesting because they're multipolar, whereas insect neurons are unipolar. The cell body sits outside the synaptic neuropil and sends a small process into the synaptic neuropil, where it then divides and forms the dendrites and the terminals. Now, nobody knows why Cajal began to work on insects, but one can imagine that in the Madrid summer, his laboratory probably smelled pretty high. I mean, they dissected human cadavers and animal cadavers and all sorts of things. They didn't have any air conditioning. So probably in the summertime, there was quite a pong in his lab, and flies were probably attracted to this. And Cajal was fascinated by vision. And he decided then he would start to work on the fly's eye, and that he did. And immediately, he began to note, he explicitly noted, interesting similarities. He showed the explicit correspondence between the cortical neurons, the visual cortex of mammal, and a part of the insect brain, which we'll encounter a little later, called the lobula. And he said the lobula, the neurons of the lobula, are similar to those in the visual cortex. And in fact, the lobula and the visual cortex are probably serve the same functions. And he would be very pleased today to know that he was probably right, because we now know from work by Karin Nordstrom in particular that a lot of these lobular neurons actually respond to orientations of edges and small moving objects as they do in the cat visual cortex. So the lobula and the cat visual cortex share many functional properties in common, and the neurons look very similar indeed. And they're also at the same level of sequential synaptic relay in insects and in the feline brain. So Cajal was not really an evolutionary biologist. He was very mixed. He had very mixed feelings about evolution, but he did recognize these interesting analogies, at least in those days, analogies. Today we might call them homologies. At least some of us would do. He also showed that the insect visual system is amazingly complicated in terms of the number of cells that are packed into a very small volume, and also the shapes and morphologies of these cells. And this is very, very convenient for us, because these cells have characteristic shapes, and these shapes occur, they are iterated column for column across the visual neuropil, each column representing one of these facets in the compound eye. So these cells have got characteristic profiles, characteristic morphologies, and we can recognize them not just in, say, a housefly, the Mosco azul that he was looking at, but we also can recognize these in Drosophila and in many other insects, in fact, all insects that have got compound eyes show a set of neurons that is common to them all. It's called the ground pattern set of neurons that's common to them all. So this is extremely convenient for us as both anatomists and physiologists. And today there are many tricks, of course, to show up these neurons using genetic drivers that are expressed then in one or another set of neurons, clonally related neurons. So there are many tricks to show up these cells, and the earliest trick was the Golgi method, and the later tricks, of course, are the genetic expression methods. In one of his last publications in 1927, I think it was, in a little book, he went even further, and he said that, in fact, the insect visual system is indeed the same as the vertebrate visual system. He was absolutely explicit, and he was an old man. He didn't have long to live, and he wrote this little book, and in this book he showed these wonderful figures. This is the insect nervous system, where we see the retina of the eye with its photoreceptors terminating on structures called monopolar cells. Don't be deceived by the name monopolar. These are like the bipolar cells of a vertebrate, and these are the bipolar cells of a vertebrate, and he made this distinct comparison and a conclusion that these and these are homologous cell types. In insects, they reverse the linear order of the retinotopic columns from one layer to the next. And then he mapped in here a kind of hybrid system of vertebrate neurons but in an insect optic lobe. And he has vertebrate neurons in a vertebrate visual system to try to show the logical sequence of his thinking from insect to vertebrate. So there's a really fascinating little picture in this book showing that he was thinking very deeply about these issues. And again, I'm biased, but I would propose anybody working in a vertebrate should just throw the animal away and come work in an insect. They're much more convenient, and they have everything that vertebrates have. And Cahal recognized that. And he wrote this, which is very, very nice. He wrote this in 1921, again, after he'd studied all these vertebrates, and he then looked at the insect. And he said, it's indubitable that zoologists, anatomists, and psychologists have slighted the insect. Compared with the retina of these apparent humble representatives of life, the retina of the bird or the higher mammal appears as something coarse, rude, and deplorably elementary. The comparison of a rude wall clock with an exquisite and diminutive hunting case watch fails to give an adequate idea of the contrast. And those are really beautiful words, because what he's saying is that, an old clunky clock would represent a vertebrate eye, and yet a beautifully engineered Swiss watch would represent the insect eye. And he was extremely impressed by what nature had done for the insect. Okay, the other great figure of that time was Sigmund Exner. Sigmund Exner was a physiologist working in Vienna in the 1880s. He actually tutored Sigmund Freud. He taught Sigmund Freud neuroanatomy. Sigmund Freud then gave up neuroanatomy and went into other things, as dreams, as we all know. Anyway, he was Sigmund Freud's tutor, and Sigmund Exner devised the optical principle. He understood and described the ray paths and the optical principles of the compound eyes of insects. And he demonstrated that each facet provides a point of light on the tips of photoreceptors, and this is the basis of mosaic vision, which was suggested much earlier. But anyway, this man is a very, very important figure in the history of invertebrate neuroscience, and also in neuron science in general. He also described envisaged interesting networks based on Cahal's observations, one of which is a Hebbian network, long before Hebb actually thought about it. It wasn't called a Hebbian network then. Okay, so let's now just get to some of the nitty-gritty of this and look at motion detection. So motion detection is something that most animals with reasonably good eyes can do. It's a very primitive or very early attribute of the visual system, and probably was one of the first attribute of a visual system to detect motion for various reasons, either for predation or for escape. So the insect visual system has been a focus on the research of mechanisms, neural mechanisms, that underlie the detection of visual motion. And the question really is, you know, what does an animal with a compound eye see, and how does it see what it sees? So the first thing we're going to discuss is what it sees in terms of the world going by its eyes. So the points we need to consider are motion vision circuits and how these are organized as part of a set of parallel pathways, and homologous with vertebrate visual systems, if possible, and then the evolutionary ground pattern of this organization. And the evolutionary ground pattern would be to get back to the original organization of neurons that provides that function. So we are all interested in various different species. We have things called models, which I hate the term myself. I think it's ridiculous. Models equal animals. We all have our favorite animal on which we work. And we discuss and we investigate the neural substrates that provide the behaviors, possibly, of that particular animal. The most interesting thing to my mind, it's a very personal view, is that we need to do a lot of comparative work to try and find out how the earliest nervous systems were put together and have been maintained over evolutionary time, 500 or 600 million years. And if we can do that, then we'll better understand the principal organizations of these systems rather than the special organizations that we find in highly advanced animals like rats, monkeys, people, and flies. Okay, the insect brain only has a few million neurons at most, maybe two or three. Some of the very big wasps, some of the big hornets, have maybe 3 million neurons. As many as 2 million neurons. I've been conservative here. Compared with the billions of brains billions of neurons in our brains, so they are much smaller, but they actually are probably as complicated or as elaborate in terms of the various nuclei or centers that the insect brain possesses. And you'll hear tomorrow more about this. It's right, quite astonishing number of centers within the small brain of Drosophila, for example. If you compare the brain of Drosophila, blow it up to the sort of size you can really see these centers, and compare it with a mouse, they're about equivalent, about as many centers in a mouse brain as there are in a Drosophila brain. Just fewer neurons are involved, but the principal organizations are probably very, very alike. So the insect is a useful organism to study. And interestingly, the amount of volume that this brain occupies in this head of this particular species is about the same as the volume that our brain occupies in our head, relatively speaking. So there's a lot of brain in a small head. Okay. There are various kinds of compound eyes which have been described. There are the apposition eyes, which in which the light is focused on a group of photoreceptors that then extend to various neurons, monopolar cells, in the first synaptic neuropil, which is called the lamina. It's a term I want you to remember. There's a thing called the neural superposition eye, which is characteristic of flies, in which groups of photoreceptors that share the same angle orientation with respect to space converge. They all look at this, they sample the same point in visual space. These photoreceptors then converge at a column in the lamina and then synapse onto these monopolar cells. Then there are other eyes, very strange eyes of some of the water bugs, where you have convergence of photoreceptors as well as divergence of photoreceptors across the lamina. But this is a mechanism that is used for nocturnal and daylight vision. It changes between daylight and nocturnal vision. And then there are other eyes called superposition eyes, where light from a rather large area of visual space is focused then onto a group of photoreceptors and then relayed to the lamina beneath, and then these monopolar cells. And the shape of these monopolar cells is basically the same, except that the dendritic spreads are different depending if the animal is diurnal or nocturnal. If the nocturnal animal, then the dendritic spreads are much, much larger, and there's a lot of interaction amongst the nerve cells, provides perhaps lateral inhibition and sharpening of the image. But the output from the lamina is standardized by these various types of cells to provide information about intensity, changes of intensity, chromatic information, and that's just about it as far as the output of the lamina is concerned. So the compound retina is not the same, of course, as our retina. We use the term retina in the insect just for the photoreceptor layer and the optics, whereas in vertebrates we use the term retina for the external internal plexiform layers, as you heard yesterday. So when I talk about retina, please don't think of the vertebrate retina. Think of this peripheral layer of photoreceptors and facets. Now I'm going to show you a part of the nervous system here. I'm going to show you actually from the other side, the right-hand side of this brain, a section through the brain to give you an idea of what it looks like. So here then is the so-called retina, the compound eyes out here to the right, and beneath it is a thin layer of neuropil called the lamina, which you can't really see very well here. Then the next layer is called the medulla. This is a very, very large neuropil. And you can see the beautiful columnar organization here that reflects the columnar organization of the compound eye. And these columns, the outputs in these columns, relate to two neuropils here. One is called the lobular plate, and you'll hear a lot more about that presently. It's a flat tectum-like neuropil. And the other neuropil here is called the lobular. It's a rather large, kidney-shaped neuropil, it looks like a broad bean, really. And both these neuropils, of course, are columnar. They receive retinotopic inputs. One of these neuropils is characterized by very large tangential dendrites that extend tangentially across the columns coming into it. And the other neuropil is characterized by palisades of pyramidal-like neurons that so impress Cajal. And it's this neuropil here that Cajal suggested was analogous to the visual cortex of a mammal. And beneath this are these areas of neuropil which are actually glomerular-like. They're like ball-like structures. And they're very important in subsequent processing. And these have been really not very well investigated until quite recently. But there's a great deal of processing going on here where the retinotopic organization is lost and that neurons converge. Outputs from this lobular, they converge to these various glomerular structures and do something very interesting indeed with respect to reconstructing aspects of the visual world. So the visual system is not just the retinotopic neuropils, it's also a very large portion of the lateral brain involved in visual processing.
Question?
Yes. Yeah, don't hesitate to ask questions if you want to ask questions. Go ahead. I don't mind being interrupted.
Visuotopic representation is lost.
Yes.
When you go to the glomeruli, but it is not sent anywhere else.
No.
So the fly makes this nice representation.
Yes.
And uses it to make some high order features in the glomeruli.
Right.
That's the idea.
Yes. Yes. So basically, the system is a system here that provides information about position of anything, including motion, and this system here encodes. Other aspects. So there are what aspects. There's a where system, if you like, and there's a what system. And the glomeruli are involved in the what, in the encoding of features. The other system, the lobular plate, and its outputs are involved in the encoding of where the features are in the visual world.
But the where does not propagate downstream the motor.
Yes, of course it does.
It does.
Yeah, absolutely. But one of the really unresolved questions is where does the what and the where converge onto the appropriate premotor neurons that do the instructions to provide the behavior? We don't know that yet. That's in the future. Okay. So here's a higher power of this. This is the lamina. And you see here this is a crossing over of projections. Axons from this neuropil cross and invade this neuropil, and axons from this neuropil cross to invade this neuropil, but they don't cross to invade this neuropil. So there's an uncross projection to this neuropil and a cross projection to this neuropil so that the columns of this and this neuropil facing each other are in register. It's really a neat organization. So this crossing over is important to remember because we'll talk about it again on Friday, Thursday. It's a characteristic of what we think are evolutionarily advanced insects and crustaceans. And you'll see here these points. These are cross-sections of very large tangential neurons that actually receive inputs from very large areas of the represented visual field. Okay, so when we go into the lamina, we can see that there are amacrine cells, very nice amacrine cells. There are centrifugal neurons that come up here from the deeper regions. They provide local interactions. There are monopolar cells that have simple dendritic spines. These are bipolar analogous to the bipolars in the vertebrate retina. These are analogous to the horizontal cells and amacrine cells. And then there are other neurons that provide lateral interactions. These are from a wasp, a fly, and you can see they're very similar indeed. And this is from a moth and a fly, very similar indeed. And this is from crustaceans. Crustaceans are also very similar to those of insects. So you have a basic subset of neurons in the lamina, which is common across insects and crustaceans. And they do basically the same thing. And how do we look at the synaptology? Well, I mean, some people are now using connectomics. A long time ago in the 1970s, which I shouldn't really admit that, but in the 1970s, what we did with Jose Campos Ortega, also from Spain, was to use Golgi impregnated material and do thin sectioning and then look at the synaptic connections onto the impregnated profiles and reconstruct the organization of the lamina that way. It's a much faster way of doing the same as you do with the connectome strategy. So you already have a labeled neuron, which you section, and then look at the synaptic connections that are involved with those impregnated profiles. So in about 3 years, we came up then with the basic wiring diagram of the lamina, where we have the photoreceptors terminating on the monopolar cells, and there is always a triplet of monopolar cells in each of these columns, which receives inputs from the receptors. There's always one single lateral connector which binds, if you like, the network binds together all the columns in the lamina. And then alongside each of these sets of terminals are two more axons from two photoreceptors that encode usually ultraviolet and blue, whereas these photoreceptors terminating on the monopolar cells encode the blue-green wavelength. This system gives rise to the achromatic system, which is involved in the reconstruction of motion and also other aspects such as edges, reflectances, and so forth. And this system plus this system provides information about chromatic properties of the visual surround. So, as in mammals with color vision, there are two parallel pathways, an achromatic and chromatic. And interestingly, the achromatic pathway, the neurons involved in the achromatic pathway, are much larger than the neurons that are associated with the chromatic pathway. So they're very similar in some respects to the magnocellular and parvocellular morphological differences that we see in the vertebrate in the primate retina. In addition, then you have wide field neurons here, which extend across arrays of these photoreceptor representations. These so-called cartridges. We have centrifugal neurons, GABAergic feedback pathways, and so on and so forth. So it has all the bits and pieces that are characteristic of the outer plexiform layer of a vertebrate. Other techniques resolve then this beautiful iterated structure. It's far more precise in terms of its appearance, at least, than any vertebrate retina. Here we see these lovely network of cross connections between the cartridges that are provided by these so-called L4 neurons. Here we see then using antibodies against aspartate and glutamate, the organization of monopolar cells in each of these cartridges, and then the organization of these more diffuse wide field connections across the system. And so we can unravel this quite nicely using various strategies, and also including Golgi electron microscopy. Okay. Now, Alosha Nen in up in Genelia Farms and others have now developed a whole suite of genetic drivers that, at least for Drosophila, resolve ensembles of neurons, such as this L4 neuron, which connects different cartridges, not only to resolve the ensemble of L4, but also to resolve single neurons within the ensemble. And they're really quite spectacular. So this is a new way of painting the visual system of Drosophila, at least. Can't do this in other species, but it's all one sort of, it's all one insect, basically. So what we see in Drosophila holds, in terms of organization, holds true for the larger species of flies, which are much more amenable for intracellular recordings using electrodes. And that's where I'm going to go next. Okay, so neurons, as I said, can be related then to the retinotopic organization stepwise through the system. Here's the lobula again. And here's one of the ensembles of neurons in the lobula. And note all the axons collect together, they collect as a bundle. So the retinotopic organization is lost here and it extends then centrally to a glomerular structure, which I will talk about a little later. And here is one of the neurons that belongs to this ensemble. So it's a system that's eminently suitable for structural analysis and to think about what it could be doing in terms of its function. Yes?
But you said that there is also an organized projection that goes elsewhere?
A retinotopic projection that goes elsewhere? Yeah, we'll come to that presently. Okay. Yes. Yes.
In this picture, what is the orientation?
Is lobular plate to the right?
So the question is, what is the orientation? This is a frontal section. We've been looking earlier at cross sections across the brain. This is now a frontal section. And the lobular plate is here. And this is the lobula. Okay? We've just turned it around like this, just so we can look at it frontally. So in the late 50s, two German scientists, Werner Reichert and Hartenstein, did some very interesting experiments where they showed that when you put an insect in a surround which has got stripes on it, and you turn the stripes, the insect will follow the stripes. Slavishly follow the stripes. And in fact, we'll do the same thing. If you put a human being within a large cylinder, the stripes, and with diffuse illumination, I have had this test myself. After a while, when the stripes are going round, you'll start to turn. You won't even realize you're doing so. And then the psychologist or the experimenter will say, "You're turning." And in fact, we do the same. We slavishly follow the stripes. It's called the optomotor response.
And you turn the opposite way when the stripes are stopped?
What?
Turn the opposite way.
Well, of course you get the illusion.
But do you physically turn?
I don't know. I haven't. Probably. I don't recall. It was a long time since I was paid for this. I just got my money in. Wait. So the optimal response is that, and the receptors are tuned to the temporal frequency of the edges rather than their angular velocity. So that's a basic principle of this system. And the question is, what neurons are computing the direction of motion to provide the motor output? And that question has been occupying many laboratories for a very long time indeed. And the answer is still, we don't really know yet exactly what's going on. And it's just a dissatisfying answer, but the research that's been involved from many laboratories has been really very exciting over the years. So if we probe deep into the system, into the lobular plate, we find there are very, very large neurons, and some of them are enormously elaborate and have dendrites that spread across the entire lobular plate. And they send messages then from one side of the brain to the other side of the brain. So they're conveying messages about motion. And this is a neuron that was recorded from by my long-time colleague, John Douglas, who worked in my laboratory for some years, using sharp electrodes. And this is from a large fly called Callifera erythrocephalus, the blowfly. But these neurons are also being described from Drosophila. So all these data are interchangeable between species, really. And when you record from this neuron and you show a flickering stimulus, just flicker, the neuron shows occasional spikes. But as soon as you provide motion, even across a very, very small area of the visual field, 3.5 degrees in this instance, the neuron starts to spike vigorously. So the neuron typically does not respond to flicker, but it responds to directional motion. And here is, this cell is called H6, and you have the grating here, you have the velocity shown here. The neuron responds with a hyperpolarization to one direction and vigorously responds with a depolarization plus spikes to the other direction. And that's characteristic of these wide-field motion-sensitive neurons. In one direction, they are inhibited, and the other direction, they respond vigorously to the direction of motion, to that direction of motion. Okay, so are these computing motion? The answer is no, they're not computing motion. They're actually collating information from lots of other neurons that presumably have computed motion and the direction of motion more peripherally. And the question is, what are those neurons that have computed the peripheral motion? So, of course, in the early days, there was a lot of thought about what kind of circuits could one have, what would be the minimal circuit that would allow the direction of motion to be computed. And this is the Reichardt-Hassenstein circuit, where you have two photoreceptors. The photoreceptors have relays to an integrator. This photoreceptor then has a channel where there is a relay, there's a delay. There's a low-pass filter, there's a delay, and there's a no delay here. So when this signal reaches, the delayed signal reaches this integrator, it is then integrated with the signal without delay from this particular photoreceptor channel. And in the opposite direction, the signal arrives here first, this signal arrives much, much later, and they're not integrated. So there's a directional motion. It's a very simple, very, very neat, simple solution to the problem. There was a second alternative pathway, which actually derives not from considerations of the behavior of the animal, which gave rise to this thought out circuit. This actually derives from recording some real neurons in the rabbit retina. And here we have then the preferred direction where this neuron gives a positive response and inhibits this particular neuron. So there's an inhibitory pathway which defines the perceived direction of the system. So, the other way around. This is the anti-preferred direction. So this then inhibits this cell in that direction, and this then provides a plus sign and summation in the other direction, in the preferred direction. So that's the Barlett-Levick directional elementary motion detector. There's no delay, there's no low-pass filter built into this. It's just purely inhibitory and excitatory connections that does the job. So the motion vision has given rise to vast numbers of alternative models that work better and better and better to explain all the experimental results that people have been gathering, both from behavior and also from the responses of deep neurons in the lobular plate. A lot of these models come from Axel Borst's lab. Axel Borst is one of the leading researchers in this area who's working in Munich. And there are vast numbers of variants of the Reichardt motion detecting circuit to explain the observed results from electrophysiological studies of deep neurons. The problem with all of these circuits has been, and actually still is, that we don't know which neurons would fit these various schemes. And that's been a real headache for the longest time. And it's also sort of provided a schism amongst researchers in that one subset of researchers and plugs in these circuits onto real neurons, and another set of researchers is trying to find circuits from real neurons. So there are two approaches. Think up a circuit which will explain the results, or devise a circuit from actual observations of how neurons are wired together to explain the results. I belong to the second school. And one aspect of our research has been to ask the question, which neurons, if you like, are sort of common denominators across all these insects that have really excellent motion vision? And flies of various kinds have really excellent motion vision, as do honeybees. So what neurons are common to these different species? And if those neurons are a small subset, it's possible that those neurons actually represent a pathway that provides a common behavioral attribute, which is visual flow field detection and high maneuverability. So long time ago, well, quite a while back, in the late 90s, Elke Buschbeck, who is a student in my lab, who's now a professor in the University of Pennsylvania, she did a very, very large survey of these different kinds of flies. Some of them which have ballistic flight, some of them which have incredibly elaborate hovering flight, others that have beautiful chasing maneuver flight, and so forth. And she asked, what are the basic subset of neurons that are common to all the medullas and laminas of these flies? And we'd focused on the medulla because we knew that in the lobular plate, these neurons were collating information, and the medulla would be the most likely place for where motion is being actually computed amongst neurons. And there was a subset, which I won't bother you with in great detail, but there was a subset of cells in the medulla which was very interesting for us. These things, L2 and L1 and L4, and all these L neurons, are the monopolar cell terminals of those cells that in the lamina receive input from the achromatic system. And the achromatic system is then sent to the outer level of the medulla, where the neurons that relay information about changes of intensity, either changes, incremental changes or decremental changes, of intensity terminate, and they end on these things called transmedullary cells, TM1 and ITM. And TM1 and ITM are more or less looking the same in all these different species. And at this level of their terminations, there are these cells called T4 cells. And T4 cells are ubiquitous to every single species of insect that has eyes that we found, and also ubiquitous to every species of melacostracan crustacean that we found. So this is a common denominator, as are these, that extend across insects and crustaceans.
How do you determine the homologies between these neurons as per morphology? Or
yes, morphology and layer relationships. Yes.
ITM corresponds to MI1 in Fischbach.
Yeah, well, there's a problem with, yes. Well, the Drosophila people have got a completely different set of terminologies. These terminologies actually should take precedence because they were published first. But unfortunately, that hasn't happened. And Carl Fischbach, who did a very beautiful study on the Drosophila medulla, decided he was going to immortalize himself and use different terms. That happens. Scientists do that quite often. They immortalize themselves by using. I hoped I would immortalize myself but it didn't really work out that way. Never mind. Anyway, so there's another set of cells too called the T5 cells that extend from the outer level of the lobular into the lobular plate. And these T5 cells get an input from the medulla by a neuron called TM1. And TM1 extends from the medulla through to the lobula. And interestingly, TM1, the terminals, the presence of TM1 really do reside above the T4 cells. So these TM1 cells end in the lobular, and they give rise to these outputs from the lobular into the lobular plate. And these outputs end at several distinct levels in this tectum-like neuropil of the lobular plate. And these distinct levels have the dendrites of neurons that we know respond to different orientations and directions of motion. And there are four major orientations of motion. There's the upward and downward, and there's the front and the back. So upward is at one level, downward is at another level, front another level, and back to at another level. So these four levels of directional encoding in the lobular plate. And these particular neurons end at these four levels. Now, there's laminas, yes. They're laminar organizations. So there is an aside here. There's a species of fly called an acelid. These are called rubber flies. And they're a bit like ballistic missiles. They sit on twigs. And they see an insect flying above them. And they do this fantastic ballistic flight, grab the insect, bring it back, and consume it. They have long bodies, which means they're very stable in terms of pitch, but they're not stable in terms of roll. And a subset of neurons that encodes vertical motion, which is incurred by perturbations of pitch, those neurons have been dispensed with through evolution, and they don't exist in acelids. So it just has two of these laminae, and these two laminae are laminae that encode horizontal motion, roll motion, and horizontal motion, and they just have two levels of terminals of these cells. So all the indications are these cells must be encoding something very important with respect to directional motion. Now, as Axel Borson and others have shown using either optical recordings or intracellular recordings, these cells in the lobular, these horizontal cells and vertical cells, the so-called giant horizontal vertical cells, they all respond to motion direction. I just want to remind you of this. So what one's looking for are the kinds of inputs onto these cells that respond to the same directionalities. And if one's found those cells, then one can ask, are those little cells that compute motion or that encode motion and provide the inputs to these cells, are those little cells computing motion, or is motion computed even more distally than those little cells? So we have this as a system. We have these giant neurons in the lobular plate. We have small field neurons in the lobular. These neurons then conspire to send their inputs to descending neurons, and these descending neurons then send their outputs onto motor neurons that provide their behavior. But when we're at this level of the system, what we're seeing basically is neurons that are collating information that's been processed further peripherally. So that's what one has to get at, those peripheral circuits. And that's quite difficult because although these neurons are large, you see, these are quite large neurons. You can drive a bus into those neurons. I mean, you can shove an electrode into those pretty easily, even in Drosophila, and get nice recordings. But the neurons further peripherally are really, really tiny. Now, again, before we go any further, I want to also emphasize, and I'll emphasize this again on Thursday morning, that what we're looking at here with the lobular plate, is actually or most likely to be the most primitive part of the visual system, the one that evolved first. Because if we go to some of the modern representatives of basal arthropods, we see a lamina and a lobular plate, and there's nothing else, just those two centers. So in some centipedes, for example, in some simple crustaceans, there's just a lamina and a lobular plate, and no crossed axons. They're all uncrossed. So in the more recent crustaceans and insects, we have a more complicated situation where we have a lamina, and we have this, if you like, primitive neuropil, and these intervening bits that have evolved later in the evolution of the system. And what we're looking at here are the computational entities that originate here. On the other hand, since this is the, if you like, the basal condition, one might expect then that motion is computed in the lamina by lamina neurons, because those are the only neurons to end in the lobular plate of the simple crustaceans and the other simple arthropods. So evolution informs us that the most likely site for motion computation is very, very peripheral. Now, it could be it's been shifted more centrally in the modern insects into the medulla. And as a precedent for this, we know that, for example, in the primate retina, there aren't motion detecting neurons. There's no motion computation performed, in at least in macaque, and a few of the other primates that have been investigated. Whereas in most mammals and almost all reptiles and fish, there are motion detecting neurons already found amongst the ganglion cells in the retina. So in vertebrate evolution, the motion detecting system in primates has been shifted more centrally from a peripheral location ancestrally.
And what was the evolutionary pressure that made it go from the left to the right glands?
I'm not sure.
But we'll discuss that on Thursday. I think the evolutionary pressure was the elaboration of the visual ecology. All right.
So,
having said that, let's move on to these cells. So, if we look at these downstream neurons that receive information from the visual system and send it to the motor output, then these cells have got complex responses. Many of them are bimodal or multimodal. They respond to wind direction and visual motion and so on and so forth. But if you recall from these neurons, it gives you an idea of the kinds of things that are encoded by the more peripheral visual system. So one usually does a sort of bottom-up approach in this game, record from descending neurons to find out what kind of features are encoded by the visual system, and then go into the inputs onto these neurons, and then go further and further peripherally to find out what's going on in terms of elementary motion computation and elementary reconstruction of the visual world to provide more and more complex primitives. Okay. So at what level of the system is directional motion reconstructed, aka computed? So this is one of these small little things called the T4 cells or the T5 cells. This is Cajal's drawing of them. He noted these and actually wrote about them and said they're very, very interesting because they're in bees and they're in flies and they're in everything. He was very impressed by these small neurons. He didn't suggest they were involved in motion processing, but he was very impressed by them because they were everywhere. This is a reconstruction from confocal microscopy of one of these cells that was recorded from by John Douglas. And this is a dendrite recording. And these are using sharp electrodes in big flies. And you find these mini spikes in the dendrites that are evoked by the direction of motion in one direction, but not in the other direction. And when you record from the axons, you find that there is a bipolar response in that. In one direction, there's an inhibition, in the other direction, there's excitation. So these neurons are behaving, essentially, like the wide-field neurons, but at a much smaller scale. And their visual field is also very, very small. It's maybe three or four armatidia are involved in relays to these neurons. So these neurons encode directional motion. The question is, do these neurons compute directional motion? So we're looking now at the neurons that terminate on these cells, the T4s and the T5 cells, which we now know are involved in directional motion. And the question is, do any of the inputs to these layers in which these cells exist actually resolve directionality? There is an interesting difference of this ITM cell with respect to flicker and to motion. There is an interesting modulation to motion in both directions, vertical and in one direction and the other, which is very different from the flicker response. So there is some sort of motion modulation in the responses of these neurons. Again, they're tiny, tiny cells in terms of their axons. They're about 1 to 1.5 microns in diameter at most in big flies. This also shows interesting motion modulation. So both of these cell types could be involved in a circuit that's computing elementary motion in terms of the direction and orientation and relaying that information onto the T4s and T5 cells. And the question is not yet resolved actually. Yes, there's a question here.
Yeah, Nick, can you just clarify what is the signature of the motion selectivity in the TM1 response?
This one here?
Yeah.
Well, we have here this, we have the grating, and we have the, well, here is the flicker, which is very simple, a very simple biphasic response. Right. And here we have a grating where the, where in one direction you see this deep, this high polarization begins before that in the other direction. The other direction gives, first of all, a depolarization. In this direction, there's a hyperpolarization. So there's a slight shift of this waveform depending upon the direction of motion. It's not very convincing, but what is convincing is that there is a very interesting response in terms of the actual change of intensity that's evoked by a moving stimulus and that evoked by a flickering stimulus. So the basic message here is that flicker and motion provide two different kinds of signals in these neurons.
So Nick, do you get different kinds of classes of TM neurons that have direction selectivity in the vertical?
Yes, there are. I'm not going to even go into that. There are other TM neurons that provide inputs to the lobula that have very, very strong directional selectivity. I think I have an example later. But these are the cells that we're looking at with respect to the lobular plate, because here the question is, what is encoding the directionality that's providing these inputs to the wide field neurons that encode then information about the visual flow fields? So the other way of going about it is to start thinking about possible circuits that could be providing an elementary motion detecting system. And using both Golgi electron microscopy and then looking also at the chemical neuroanatomy of these neurons. For example, this particular cell type, these two cell types here are a resolve showing aspartate and glutamate. Other cells have, we think they're cholinergic, other cells are GABAergic. So for every one of these candidate neurons, the ITM and the TM1, there is a chemical signature associated with them that helps. And it also helps to inform us that these cells are arranged one per column, that they are actually distributed iteratively across the retinotomic mosaic. Of course, now in Drosophila, you can obtain drivers that show these cells indeed are iterated one per column. But this was before these drivers existed. And the end product then is an organization like this, where we have the achromatic system terminating on monopolar cells in the lamina. These monopolar cells then terminate at these levels here, and just looking at one particular monopolar cell, which is the L2 cell, it then provides a set of relays onto this cell called the TM1 that terminates on the T5 cells, and at this level in the lobula, there are then GABAergic neurons that provide relays between these inputs and the T5. So we have a system of excitatory neurons and GABAergic neurons, which provide connections between adjacent relays. And I'll show this more explicitly in a moment in the diagram. So that's how we got, that's as far as we got. And the end point was the suggestion that this part of the system provided a non-directional Reichardt-like motion detector, where a surround of receptors would provide relays, each of which had a delay component in it, to a central receptor that had no delay component, and provided then a motion detector of the Reichardt type that would respond to motion in any direction. It would distinguish between motion and flicker, but it was non-directional, totally non-directional. And that this subsequent set of relays would compute the directionality of that non-directional signal. It sounds sort of counterintuitive. You have two motion detectors, but that's the kind of organization that this organization suggested. So at one level, there was a Reichardt-like elementary motion detector. And at the deeper level, there was a Barlow-Levick type elementary motion detector.
So, Nick, I just want to add that we do need a non-directional motion sensor to explain some of our behavior results.
Yes, right.
Yes.
That's nice to see those neurons.
And I think actually we discussed that point, you and I, when I think you've seen that before, and it's true. You do need a set of non-directional motion detectors, and you need directional motion detectors as well. So there would be one very nice system to achieve both. Yes?
Nick, what are TM9 neurons needed for?
TM9 neurons are very interesting neurons. These are GABAergic relay neurons that receive inputs also from the achromatic system, and they jump a column. So they provide connection between one column and the next.
It's obliquely
vertically in one direction, and of course beneath the equator is in this direction. So it's just one direction.
Right.
But then you have another system of GABAergic neurons here, which provide the other direction. So there are two directional components. And it's the same at the T4 level, which I haven't shown here. You have also this system at the T4 level.
And what's the neuron analogous to TM9 in the T4 system?
Oh, we don't know. We think it's a second ITM, second intrinsic neuron, but we're not sure. Okay, and then at least then that kind of organization provided a rather elaborate, if you like, neuromorphic motion detecting circuit that Charles Higgins, who is a colleague of mine at the University of Arizona, he's an engineer, devised using all the available data from the biology. And working just from the biological data, including some of the electrophysiological recordings, or all of them that John Douglas had achieved, and also the anatomical recordings, and also those chemical anatomy stains, the antibody stains that showed us which pathways were inhibitory. And this is then what he got, two T5 neurons, one which would then provide leftward motion, one which would provide rightward motion. And he implemented this as a silicon circuit, and then provided this with a retina, and this thing would drive a balloon, a little dirigible, around the room, which would avoid objects and correct its correct itself of visual flow field perturbations at a very slow speed. But at least it worked like a lamina. Okay.
But the signs were detected by knowing what the neurotransmitters are?
Yes. And also whether the neuron was excited or inhibited by motion. Yes.
Nick, the pathway, the leftmost pathway, RHPP, PF, and amacrine.
Yeah. Yes.
So what is that amacrine to what?
Is amacrines to L2. Amacrines
to
L2.
Also to
L2. Yeah. Amacrines to L1, amacrines to L1, amacrines to L2, yes.
I see.
So L2 would be for on, L1 would be for off increments.
So then L1 and L2 have to converge in TF1.
That's right.
Is that true?
Maybe not, but...
Okay.
So that was, anyway, that was a that was an example of a neuromorphic model, which is derived not from thinking about how things should be put together, but derived from what we thought was realistic in terms of how things seem to be put together. However, you don't really need all that, because you can get away just with a Barlow-Levick system at two levels, at this level and at this level. And you can get away with a Barlow-Levick system where you have one system is getting inputs about off increments from the responses of photoreceptors, and the other from on increments, light on and light off in the traditional fashion. And you have these two Barlow-Levick motion detectors, one in the medulla and one in the lobula, providing the relevant levels of inputs into the lobular plate. And you have then everything you need for the encoding of motion. And this suggests that the actual computation of motion must be occurring at this level in the medulla and at this level in the lobula, involving the GABAergic pathways and the TM9 and this wide field amacrine-like cells, the dendrites of which are acting locally rather than globally, and then your so-called M1 cells, we use Drosophila terminology here, and the TM1 cells providing the cholinergic inputs, the excitatory inputs. Yes?
So presumably one interesting question is, if you look across insects using the comparative method, how variable is this
circuit? We looked in cockroaches even, and also honeybees, and what we see is the same.
Same at every detail, or there are small variations that do not matter?
Well, there are small variations in the size of neurons. In crepuscular species, many of these relays have got wider dendritic fields.
But the actual circuit topology is conserved.
The circuit topology is conserved, and we find the circuit topology appears to be conserved in crustaceans. In many insects, there's no lobular plate. The lobular plate actually sits down here beneath the lobular, as in honeybees. So these cells that extend from the lobular to the lobular plate in a fly actually extend from here to a deep level in the lobular in a honeybee. When you look at a crustacean, it's the same. You have cells extending to a deep level in the crustacean lobular. So we see basically the same organization. It's a highly conserved organization across the pancrustacea.
Well, that I believe. What I'm asking is, if you were to look for the differences,
yes,
do you find interesting differences?
Well, we have looked for the differences. We've been looking for the similarities. So I'm sure there are interesting differences, which might certainly be reflected on the...
to the specific...
Right, yes.
So Nick, on the question of the Arlo Levick versus the Reichardt model, didn't someone some time ago, I don't know if it was your lab or somewhere else, where they dumped a paper toxin on the lobular plate, which is presumably homologous the GABA inhibition.
Yes, I think
they
that
found
was...
that there was an elevated response.
Yes.
Suggesting really that it is inhibition that's doing the...
It was actually Axel's lab, Yes, but they didn't follow it up. There was no mention of a Barlow-Levick circuit.
Nick is going against Reichardt.
Right, I know.
Well, there we are.
Yes. But this is the most parsimonious explanation for this organ, for this system, and it's the most global. And in fact, if this is also the parsimonious circuit of the vertebrate retina for motion computation, then what we have here is an organization that is very, very ancient indeed and may have existed before the divergence of the vertebrates and invertebrates. I would come back to your question of convergent evolution,
right,
which is, again, I find the most unparsimonious view of similarities.
The same circuits, obviously, been in contact.
Right. Yeah.
Circuits that are only present in some branches. But when you say this, when you're comparing this with vertebrate retina, now that Moritz, for example, has the actual circuit, are you going to try to match up neuron by neuron, or are you going to look at overall patterns?
Well, we can't match up neuron by neuron, as I only have one life, but it would be very, very nice to do that. One would hope other people would actually follow this up and look more closely at these what I think are really profound similarities.
Across. Why is it possible, you think, to take a circuit diagram that he is about to give us within a few months' time and try to find which neurons
would fit in the insect? Yes, why not?
Absolutely.
Okay, and then very recently from the Bors lab, Lois Chanern has got a driver which actually specifically expresses in the T4 and the T5 neurons, and you can drive then the expression of fluorescent green protein, or you can drive expression of temperature sensitive knockout, or you can drive expression of some ghastly toxin which will lock it up permanently. So if you knock out these systems in Drosophila using this driver, you abolish directional motion perception by lobular plate neurons. So I think the it's very, very clear that the T4s and T5s, and there's a whole volume of evidence, T4s and T5 cells, these little cells, are encoding directional motion. And I personally think that there is reasonably good evidence that the actual computation of directional motion is occurring at these two levels in the system.
So
Sorry, it might be a little bit more detailed, but have you seen morphological differences between different T4s or T5s?
Yes.
Correlated with which
pair
they project?
Okay, so these
L cells are very unusual. As I mentioned beforehand, neuron types are iterated across the retinotopic mosaic. So each column has one of these TM1 cells that goes from the medulla into the outer level of the lobula. But these T4s and T5 cells are very different indeed. Each column contains four of these, a quartet of these cells. And these cells have asymmetric dendrites, which are organized in the retilinear organization. So each column has a set of T cells that are organized like this, a set of T cells that are organized like this, and a set of T cells that are obliquely organized. And these dendrites are very, very interesting because they are thick and then they taper. And the dendrites on one side of the T4 are shorter than the other side of the T4. So there's this very interesting asymmetry of the T4 neuron itself.
But is it correlated with the sub?
Yes, it's correlated with the depth they're terminating in the lobular plate. I think we wrote that, or it's written, I think maybe in that silly book I wrote, maybe not in the publication. Anyway, okay. So visual flow field analysis. So in the late 70s, Roland Hengstenberg in the Max Planck Institute in Tübingen and his student Holger Krapp did something really neat. They began to record from the dendrites of these wide field neurons in the lobular plate, because they wanted to know why were these dendrites so peculiarly organized in different parts of the lobular plate. What do these differences organization mean? And they assumed that on the dendrites, there were terminating on these dendrites these elementary motion detectors. They didn't know they were T4s or T5 cells, but they knew there must be elementary motion detectors terminating on these dendrites. So they recorded from the neurons, and they provided then the eye local stimuli in certain directions, downwards or upwards or obliquewards and so forth. So you can imagine when the animal is lifting, that the visual flow field or the visual panorama will appear to be moving downwards across the eye, and when the animal is undergoing roll, here is the fulcrum, then on one side motion will be going up, the other side motion will be going down. So do these neurons, these wide field neurons, encode precisely that kind of information? So here then would be the directions of say velocity vectors of a forward moving fly. And the question is the neuron that is receiving inputs, does the neuron actually have encoded in its dendrites precisely those vectors? And the answer is yes, otherwise I wouldn't be showing you this. So here is this cell called a VS8 neuron. These are called vertical cells. There are in fact, I think in Drosophila, 10 of them or 11, and in big flies there are, I think, 12 or 10, not sure anymore. But each of these cells, if you like, embraces or subtends a specific vertical strip of the relayed retinotopic mosaic, and therefore a specific vertical strip of the surrounding visual panorama. And these cells respond to this vectorial information in the visual world. So this cell is responding to front-to-back motion and these dendrites are responding to front-to-back motion, and these dendrites are responding specifically from downward motion. These dendrites map quite differently into the retinotopic mosaic, and they are mainly responding to downward motion, as are these dendrites of this cell here. And they've looked at all these cells, and each cell responds to or is tuned to a different organization of these components of the visual flow field. And together they provide information that's relevant to the animal keeping, basically maintaining visual balance. So if there's any perturbation of the animal's, if you like, visual stance, that perturbation will be encoded by these sets of neurons. It's a really gorgeous system. So, that's very briefly said. But then there's other things too that flies do. They don't just fly and avoid obstacles or, you know, keep visual balance and detect perturbations of the flow field. They also chase each other. Flies have sex on the wing, most of them do, and they chase each other. And this was a very, very beautiful behavioral study originally performed by Thomas Collett and Michael Land at the University of Sussex. And what they did was, one of them held an old movie camera, well, then those days a sort of video movie camera, actually, and the other one shot peas from a pea shooter, and they were watching flies intercept these peas and filming these flies. And there were these two characters sort of rushing around on the greens of University of Sussex. And any visitor might think they were really quite weird professors, sort of under, you know, just exhibiting strange professorial behavior. But in fact, they were doing some really important research. And eventually they were then looking at how flies actually interact with, not with peas, but with each other. And they filmed then a lot of these traces of flies chasing each other. And here's one. This is the chasing fly. This is the male. And this is the female. And this is second one, second two, or sorry, interval one, two, three, four, five, six. I think it's the seconds. And these are fractions of a second. Here is one chasing the female. The female undergoes an avoidance maneuver. And within one, two, three, I think these are tenths of seconds. So in 3/10 of a second, this male has already computed the direction taken by the female and is chasing her. The female then changes again. She does this incredible loop. And the male detects this even faster, follows her. She does a complete rotation, a complete loop. He does the same thing. And eventually, she gets away. But it shows you how fast the system is actually operating to detect a direction and to also encode position of the leading object. And they came out with this model. They said there must be two systems allowing this. One is a velocity system, which detects the direction of motion, either from on-axis to off-axis or off-axis to on-axis, and one is a position system, which would detect the position of the target. So this is too good to leave, and so we looked at the males and females of big flies, Calophora, and this is the male, and you see there's a very, very distinct difference between the organization of the retinae, the photoreceptor array of these animals. The radius of curvature here is much, much greater than elsewhere on this eye, and you don't have this component at all in the female. And because the radius of curvature is much larger, the angular disparities between the optical axes of neighboring ommatidia are smaller. The ommatidia are larger, but the angle separating different ommatidia are smaller. So there's a higher resolution afforded by this frontal part of the eye. And you go into the actual brain of a male and a female, you can find in the male lobula, not in the lobulate, in the male lobula, there is this very high density of neurons sitting here in the upper part of the lobula, which represents the front part of the eye of the male. Whereas the equivalent, or the most frontal part of the eye of the female, has nothing like that at all. And then if you go into the actual neurons, if you look at the neurons, then in the male, there are these amazing neurons that don't exist in the female. In fact, there are tiny whinging little neurons in the female, which are homologs. But we don't want to bother with those really at all here. There are these huge neurons in the male. In the lobula, it's not in the lobular plate. That's very, very interesting. Because when we record from those neurons, wait, before I go, it's very interesting. So we can actually then map these male neurons into the retinotopic organization of the lobula. Each of those points represents a column, and each of those columns represents a facet. And using Mike Land's eye maps, we can then translate those facets into directions that the receptors in those facets are pointing with respect to the visual panorama. And we can then presume, or we can then predict the visual field, the receptive field of these male neurons. And the receptive field of these male neurons are all concentrated around this high-resolution area, which is called the love spot by those that work on this thing. Some people have called it the fovea. It's not a fovea. It's a high-resolution area. And you record from this thing, and you find that these neurons actually respond very, very nicely to directional motion. But they're not in the lobular plate, and they don't get inputs from T4s and T5 cells, which strongly suggests that those cells are receiving elementary motion detectors of a different kind from the medulla. So there's not just one system of elementary motion detectors, there's a second system in operation here. And then you have, this is true for all these. This is beautiful, this particular cell. This is the MLG1, the male lobular giant type 1, which sends its terminals to an area here of the brain on which it synapses to cells that provide then information to the flight motor system, the steering muscles of the flight motor system. And this neuron responds very, very obviously to directional motion. And there is a position system, according to Mike Land and Tom Collett, must exist, and indeed it does. And these are cells here, which are male-specific, and they respond also to directional motion, and they respond then to small areas. So they respond to motion in small areas in the visual field. Cut a long story short, there's a kind of wiring diagram that we can envisage, where we can actually provide from recordings of real neurons. So each one of these lines represents a real neuron that's been recorded from and identified morphologically. We have neurons that respond to motion from the on-axis to off-axis. We have neurons that respond to motion from off-axis to on-axis, exactly as predicted by Land and Tom Collett. We have other neurons that respond to both directions. They're non-directional motion detectors. And then we have these small neurons that in the front respond to targets on axis, pretty much on axis to the eyes, and then these lateral neurons that respond to targets off axis. And another neuron here with very interesting graded dendritic field that might provide information about position of those off axis neurons. And these then conspire to provide the relevant outputs to the motor system. One set of neurons which is deriving the bilateral direct flight muscles, which provides the indirect flight muscles, which provides the power. These are the power muscles that provide acceleration or deceleration, and another system that goes to the direct flight muscles, which are involved in changing the torque of the wings, the vaulting of the wings, and the steering. So this is a very nice system which has been predicted by behavioral studies and has been really confirmed anatomically and physiologically to be there. So some behaviors really do predict anatomy, and that's great. All right, now what about from the medulla to the lobula and beyond? So we've been looking at the lobula of the male. We've shown that there is a second motion system which is characteristic to the male. What about all the rest of this junk here in the lobula? Now the lobula receives about 80% of the medulla outputs. 80% of the medulla outputs are involved in lobula, and the other 20%, that's generous, are involved in the lobular plate. So the lobula is receiving the chromatic information and a lot of the achromatic information as well. So what's it doing? Well, it's involved probably in the reconstruction of the visual world, not as we know it, but as the fly would recognize it. The neurons that leave the lobula, leave the medulla for the lobula, are really very difficult, very boring, because we have no idea really what they're tuned to. We've just tried to do motion responses, but they're very uninteresting. But that's not so for deeper neurons. Those are much more interesting. So this is a neuron that goes to the lobular plate and to the lobula. It encodes directional motion very, very strongly indeed. It's not a T4 or T5. It's a directional motion-sensitive neuron which goes to both lobular and lobular plate and terminates on one of these columnar neurons here. This is the orientation of this. And the lobular output is also broadly tuned. This is the recording from a lobular output, which is broadly tuned to orientation. So these lobular outputs are fascinating. And we've recorded a lot of these in big flies, and they have centers around organization. They are tuned rather broadly to a direction, and they respond to very, very small moving edges of a particular orientation. So they're rather like complex cells in the cat visual cortex. And as I mentioned earlier, the lobula was for Cajal the cortex of the fly, the visual cortex of the fly. And he would be very pleased, I think, indeed, to see that he is sort of vindicated by that prediction from the recordings that have been obtained from these cells. These neurons terminate in glomeruli. These are ball-like networks. They're ball-like aggregates of neural processes. And they're known best of all from the olfactory system. The olfactory system is composed of olfactory glomeruli. In the olfactory system, each type of olfactory receptor neuron that encodes a particular odorant terminates in a particular olfactory glomerulus. So each glomerulus in the olfactory system represents a particular small range of odorants. But we have the same organization here for the visual system. And that is absolutely fascinating, as you'll, I think, presently hear. Okay, so here's one type of these neurons, and here's another. It's a really neat cell. As you see, these cells have got rather broad tuning with respect to their these output cells from the lobule to this glomerulus are rather broadly tuned to direction. This is a relay that extends its dendrites into a glomerulus and sends its axons then down to the thoracic ganglia, where it terminates amongst motor circuits. And here it's a much, much tighter tuning to an orientation. So something is going on here in the olfactory glomerulus which fine-tunes the outputs and gets rid of the slop, of the noise, of the imprecisions of these lobular inputs. So again, returning to the retinotopy, these cells here are retinotopic, but their terminals are not. They all cluster together and provide a summed input to the glomerulus. And what we think is happening is that these amacrine cells, these local interneurons that connect glomeruli, are in fact involved in the fine-tuning amongst glomeruli and reconstructing a further increment of the visual world. They are actually providing higher order visual primitives, higher order than those leaving the lobula. Okay, so let's summarize the visual system so far. We have two kinds of pathways. We have the achromatic pathway, which provides motion information to the lobular plate onto these wide field neurons. And the lobular plate then encodes motion and position. So retinotopy is, in a sense, preserved in the lobular plate. We also have this other path, which involves achromatic relays and also color. And that pathway then extends to the lobular. And that pathway ends on these wonderful palisades of lobular output neurons. There are about 21 types of lobular output neurons in Drosophila, somewhat more in big flies. And these lobular output neurons then terminate in these various glomerular domains, just like the olfactory receptors terminate in the domains of the olfactory system. So this is called the optic glomerular complex. That is the organization, and it's very similar to that in the primate. We have the photopic and the scotopic pathways. We have the color-coded pathways. If you like, a magnocellular and parvocellular pathway. And then we have, in the deeper levels here, these interesting islets, which have lost retinotopy, and they are reminiscent of blobs in area 18, 19. And so here then is something which I find personally intriguing in terms of evolutionary biology. We have here these filter-specific domains, these visual glomeruli at this level here. At this level here, we have these odotypic domains, the glomeruli of the olfactory system. This is a segment of the visual system called the deutercerebrum. This is another segment of the visual, of the central nervous system of the brain called the protocerebrum. So we have, this is the first segment of the brain, second segment of the brain, and then there are further segments. In the thoracic ganglia, we have segmental organization. In the thoracic ganglia, we also have these very specific domains like glomeruli that are volumetric territories, that each of which receives inputs from a particular kind of receptor. So we have repeated for segment the same ground pattern of circuits, if you like, of glomerular circuits that serve different sensory systems. And I will show you on Thursday the most primitive or the earliest visual systems in which every single segment is homonymous, it's iterated. There's no difference of the segments. And one can envisage that through the course of evolution, as various kinds of limbs had evolved with various kinds of receptors, photoreceptors, chemoreceptors, mechanoreceptors, acoustic receptors, that these territories basically remained the same, but were modified in terms of shape and so forth, depending upon the kind of receptor modalities that they served. Okay, so higher order visual processing is likely to have the same kind of arrangements and exceptologies as higher order olfactory processing. And it's interesting because olfactory processing has no spatial component. You can't detect where an odor is coming from unless you have a wind and you can do kind of casting towards the odor. You can't actually have a map of odors. And in fact, you don't really have a map of shapes with the visual system. You have two kinds of lines. You have lines that are encoding what, and you have another line which is encoding where. Okay, so now, to summarize this, we have then the visual system, and each one of these colored bands represents one or another kind of output neuron. So each of these output neurons terminates in a particular glomerulus. So these are labeled lines of information. They encode different aspects of the visual world. The glomeruli are integrated amongst each other by these amacrine cells, and then these relay information, higher order information, onto premotor pathways. And in the olfactory system, you have the same. You have batteries of olfactory receptors, each field of which is specialized to detect a particular odorant. And here is work Barry Dixon's lab showing these various species of olfactory receptor neurons. And these olfactory receptor neurons, each of which encodes a different odorant, terminates in a different glomerulus. These are labeled lines, and local interneurons compute information amongst these various glomeruli. The two systems, at least for me, are essentially identical and must have evolved from the same ground pattern. But they deal with two very different modalities. Okay, so some of you are engineers here, and you probably want to know about, you know, how suitable is the flight visual system for reverse engineering circuits for contextual scene processing, for example, by robot platforms. I've already mentioned that Chuck Higgins devised a very nice neuromorphic circuit, a reverse engineered circuit from the lamina medulla projections, lobular plate projections, that provides visual flow fields for a robotic dirigible. And now we would like to know if we can use the same kind of strategy for doing other kinds of games. So we have here basically, you know, the motion of direction, and this is the two-step, the Reichardt step plus the Hassenstein, the Barlow-Levick. This is a bit propaganda-ish. It's a slide that was prepared for the Air Force Research Labs, which we both have funding from. So we have a motion direction system which involves rather few neurons in the medulla, extending into the lobular plate, where you have these layers of large tangential motion encoding systems. We have then other neurons that are involved in object motion, maybe object position, in the lobular plate. And then finally, we have these other neurons, which I haven't shown you because time is limited, which in the medulla already encode very, very tiny edges and orientations. These are the T2 neurons. and they terminate in the lobula on these ensembles of lobular outputs, each of which then extends to a glomerulus, and these ensembles encode primitives such as edges, orientations, and color. And then interactions amongst these glomeruli encode simple shapes and colors, And you'll hear, I think, from Srini that bees, for example, are really interested in simple shapes and colors. Nothing complicated that we see, but that's perfectly adequate for an insect to survive over millions of years of evolution, which certainly we will not. We can be sure of it. We're too destructive. So anyway, this is a wonderful system. Now, can we, you know, do any kind of reverse engineering? Well, first of all, this is really ripe for emulating. We know the neurons that provide inputs to it. We know which emotion-sensitive neurons, these Y cells that provide inputs into it. So this would be a fantastic system to really work at to provide a following device. The only problem with this is that how does it interact with the visual flow field system? And presumably, they must mutually inhibit each other, and there must be some additional element that gates the inhibition according to a particular circumstance that the fly perceives in its world, maybe an olfactory signal, to switch off visual balance and to switch on visual chasing. And then we have these neurons and this wonderful system. And this is a study that's just been published from our lab in Journal of Neuroscience earlier this year. And these are neurons in Drosophila, which have been recorded by Lai Yong Mu using patch electrodes. So he obtains Drosophila lines in which you can drive fluorescent green protein in subsets of these neurons, and then using live imaging, he then gloms onto the cell body of one of these neurons and records from it, and then later on stains the cell with a dye in the context of these other cells. And these neurons in Drosophila are really, really small. None of them exceed 0.5 microns in diameter. They're very small, and they have really miserable responses. There's a lot of noise, none of them spike, but when you do the summed response in the optic glomerulus, the response is extremely clean and encodes a particular orientation. So there's a signal-to-noise averaging device here in the optic glomerulus, and this information then is passed onto descending neurons. So the cleaning is done here at this level, and the elaboration of the output is done then amongst these cells at that level. So that's something to model. Here is then an example of these cells. You can put TTX into these cells, get rid of the synaptic noise, and you see that there's a huge amount of intrinsic noise in these very small cells. Not much good for spikes, but they do provide quite nice responses, which, when you look at them, the sum response provides information about orientation selectivity of these various neuron types. And then we have then the question of how do these glomeruli interact, and Chuck Higgins is actually working.
No, I won't comment on mollusks, because mollusks are a real pain in the arse, actually.
But the octopus eye, I guess.
Well, the octopus eye is again, you know, Carl was fascinated in the octopus eye, and he thought it was very, you know, there were commonalities in terms of the organization of layers, rhizotopic organization, and so forth. Of course, the octopus eye is right side out, as ours is inside out, the rest of it.
But in terms of the circuits that you were showing?
Well, we don't really know much about the circuits. That's the trouble with octopus. You know, you show octopus an electron and it dies. I mean, octopus is really, really difficult to record from. Terrible necrotic problems in octopus. Which is a tragedy, because so much work was invested in octopus by J.J. Young and his colleagues in Naples. And we know a lot about the anatomy, and the behavior is fabulous. Yeah, and the behavior is fantastic. It's a wonderful learner. It learns by observation, all these good things, you know. So it's definitely from outer space. And we have no idea, really, how this is evolved. So this is, I think, one possible divergence. This is one possible sort of convergent example but maybe using very different principles. For example, octopus doesn't have color vision, right? It has polarized light vision, doesn't have color vision, and yet it can actually, it disguises itself as the colors of its substrate. So how does it do that? There's no color vision. So my idea is that it's got peripheral color vision on the skin, that there's local color detectors which are directly informing the chromatophores. So nobody's actually looked at this properly at all. I was suggesting this to a NASA conference, and people thought I was completely mad. Mm-hmm. But it's the most logical explanation. So if that's true, then it has really, really a very different organization than anything you would expect from an insect or a vertebrate. But the lophotrochs are fascinating because they also include the polychaete worms, right? And some polychaetes are compound eyes. Nobody looked properly at the polychaete visual system, but as I'll show you tomorrow, the polychaete brain has a lot that's common to the brains of insects and crustaceans. So the lophotrochozoans do show fundamental ground principles of organization. But octopus and cephalopods, that's tough.
Well, maybe challenges for some of the people in the audience.
Yes.
Like real challenges. Well, questions?
I'm curious about the,
Is it working now?
Yeah, it's working, okay. I'm curious about the where and the what pathway distinction that you mentioned. With as far as invertebrates are concerned and the fly, would you really call these two pathways a where pathway and a what pathway? Or would you say the lobular system is really, okay, maybe a what pathway, but the lobular plate system is not so much a where pathway as it is a motion sensing pathway.
Yeah.
So it's motion as opposed to object vision. Motion vision and object vision rather than where and what.
Well, it is motion vision at least. Yes, you're right, but I'm not sure it's only motion vision. The lobular plate also has small field retinotopic neurons that provide their own outputs. So there is a second system in the lobular plate, in addition to these wide field motion sensitive neurons, that I suspect has less to do with looking at global motion than maybe determining where in the visual field there's something salient. Very generally, some salient component that would be of interest for the flight to turn towards, for example, or to chase, or whatever.
So if we look at it in the vertebrate pathway, or the mammalian pathway, or even the primate pathways, I mean, the cortex and all of the other. The what is the cortex?
Yes.
And the where is what is it exactly? Where
thalamus,
would be?
I don't know.
It's all.
Somewhere where acoustic information converges. I mean, yeah.
Right.
Mm. I mean, certainly there's a where, very fast where pathway,
just fixating things.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm. So it is, in a sense, motion sensitive, but it's directing the thing towards the object of interest.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Just a general question: How do you test insects for their motion behavior? Just with what is the environment besides what you showed us? Do you use virtual environment, for instance?
People use virtual environments, yes. Or artificial, very artificial ones, such as having a random background with an object, looking at foreground background, relative motion, object detection within a cluttered environment, all the things that insects can do. But others use very naturalistic scenes. Both. Yeah.
I was going to say, when I add to that, people have devised for insects real virtual environments where you can put the insect in closed loop, as it were. So the insect exerts a force or a torque, and that's coupled back to the virtual environment to make it turn in the appropriate direction. So the insect really has the feeling that it is moving in place.
It's a flight simulator.
So and the experimenter has a feeling that he's inside the insect.
But is it possible these days to insert electrodes and have a behaving fly, for instance?
With electrodes?
Yeah.
Yes. And people like David O'Carroll does that often. And Karen Nordstrom and others. Yes.
So there's some in the flight simulator, there's some in the walking flight.
Yeah, and Mike Dickinson up in University of Washington, he actually, his people do patch clamp recording of some of these large neurons with a fly that's in a virtual environment, but it's attached, it's an attached preparation. Doesn't seem to stress out the insect terribly. One would think, did it to a monkey, it would be very difficult to interpret the data.
But how reliable is the behavior of these insects?
It depends on the stimulus. But you can drive some behaviors very, very reliably. Probably others, probably not at all, because those behaviors will be very specific to a combination of multimodal events.
We're just going to say, in our experience, flies are much easier to fool in a virtual environment than bees. Mm. Bees somehow realize that they're being tethered and they don't cooperate. Flies are a lot easier.
It's
a glue flight at the end of the stick and put flight. Yeah, bumblebees are easier than honeybees, apparently. Bumblebees are more robust and they don't. I think maybe honeybees, they get desperate. I mean, it's a psychological problem. They catch a honeybee, can't get back home. And
yeah, I think
it feels desolate.
I'm convinced they have feelings.
Oh, yes.
I won't be talking about it.
No. When you talk, I'm going to talk about brain evolution, and I'm going to show you that they
do
must
they refuse
must
to fly,
have
then?
Yeah,
do they refuse to fly?
Yeah. Yeah.
They fly. I mean, I know a long time ago, for my PhD thesis, which is a very long time ago, guys, I was able to close the loop on a fly, and there was no problem. And just a year ago, one of my PhD students tried to do the same thing, close the loop on a bee, and it just doesn't work. It would fly, but it behaved as though it wasn't paying attention to the stimulus. Mm-hmm. It was just doing its own thing.
We should give it more interesting stimulus. Maybe you're insulting its intelligence.
Nice flowers.
I mean, these brains are packed full of peptidogenic and neural hormonal systems and pathways. Many of these come from feedbacks from the gut, from the viscera. From the heart. So the brain is being modulated all the time by a vast number of centrifugal inputs, as is ours. I mean, our brain sits in a soup of hormones and God knows what else. Same is true for any insect brain. So they are really, really, really subject to stress and to all sorts of other factors which are very difficult to quantify or even identify. Yes.
More questions.
So I think let's thank Nick again and you.